I would like to welcome on stage Sandrine Dixson-Decleve, a huge supporter of ours. We're so grateful for her to be here. She is co-president of the Club of Rome and probably the most phenomenal speaker I have ever heard. Welcome.
Thank you so much, Amanda. Thank you, Nina. It's a real pleasure for me to be here once again. I hope that some of you have followed our journey from the Club of Rome and some of the speeches that I've given here before. I come back every year because I fundamentally believe that this show, this exhibit, is so important in terms of shifting the fashion industry to truly being sustainable. What I want to do is to lead you through our journey at the Club of Rome. How many of you have read The Limits to Growth? Anybody? Wow. I'm pleased to see at least some of you in the crowd. The Limits to Growth was published in 1972, more than 50 years ago, and the predictions already in The Limits to Growth indicated that we would go far beyond the planetary boundaries, that due to growing population, economic impacts, exponential growth, we would actually start to feel the tipping points in the 2020s. Fast forward to 2009, and we have the planetary boundary science that's already showing us that we are starting to move through those planetary boundaries, and now we are 6 out of 9 planetary boundaries over. In 2022, when we were supposed to celebrate, and I call it a commemoration, not a celebration, because how do you celebrate the Limits to Growth publication in 1972, 50 years later, and realize that actually most people didn't listen? That we truly are now in a situation where we have gone far beyond those limits. And that's why we published Earth for All, a Survival Guide for Humanity. A book which turned into an initiative which has been translated in 10 different languages, and where we are now bringing people on the movement of showing them that yes, the reality is dire, but the possibilities are huge, and part of those possibilities are here. And then just last year, we worked with the UN to try to encapsulate our thinking into SDGs for all. Because what we're saying, people, is that actually well-being is declining. This is not just about the planet. This is about us. We are nature, nature is us, and therefore we need to ensure that actually we enhance well-being across the globe. We saw in our G20 survey that we've actually just redone this year that more than 70% of G20 citizens want to move into a well-being economy. So what does that look like? Well, interestingly enough, we're not the only ones that are starting to see that a well-being economy is actually dependent on dealing with social risks and environmental risks. If you look at the top risks that have been rated by CEOs across the globe, you can see that the global risk landscape is featuring actually predominantly social and environmental risks. And the compound effect of both of them is one of the reasons why we are actually seeing well-being go down, social tension go up, because of inequality going up across the globe. This is the first generation making less than its parents. So how do we turn that around? How do we start to talk about the elephants in the room? Elephant number one, we know that associated lifestyle consumption emissions are greatest in the global north, not the global south. And that actually it is the richest 10% that are producing most of those emissions. It is there that we have our greatest material footprint, and we know that the fashion industry is a huge contributor to that material footprint. But there are other deep elephants in the room. They get bigger and more difficult to solve. The poorest 50% take less than 15% in total earnings, while the richest 10% take well over 40%. Wealth distribution across the globe is not happening. Liberal economics that told us that the trickle-down theory would mean that as we grew, more people would feel that wealth. That doesn't happen. And what we're seeing is that this is not only in the global south or between the global south and the global north. This is within the global north. I grew up in California. Has anybody been to San Francisco these days? Did anybody trip over heroin, needles, feces? We're now called Poop Town. in California, the richest state in the United States. The fact of the matter is that CEOs in the United States, their wealth and actually their salaries has gone up by 1,400% since 1978. Does anybody know what the equivalent is for employees in the US since 1978? Anyone hedge a guess? 18%. What were you going to say? One. Wow, that's pretty low. But 18% in comparison to 1,400% is still pretty low. Inflation in most countries has gone up by 20%, if not more. We know what the inflation rate is in Argentina. It's multiplied by many factors. So the fact is that these elephants in the room are truly having an impact on our well-being. And if we look at global salaries and life satisfaction linked to salaries, what you see is actually GDP per capita per person and life satisfaction. When we're down in about 20,000 or underneath, clearly life satisfaction is not that high. But then when you start to go up to 40,000, it starts to get higher. What's interesting, is the peaking at 60,000. People across the globe actually start to see less satisfaction when they actually hit around 60,000 in terms of salary. Now, clearly, this depends which country you're in, your purchasing power, but the fact of the matter is the more people make, the less satisfied they are with their lives. The more they're dependent on material goods, the less satisfied they are. Now let's come to a real reality check, another big elephant in the room, the European elections. I live in Brussels. And if you look at life satisfaction, what we've heard over the last few weeks, in particular with the radical right that has actually hijacked the narrative, it is that people's lives are getting harder. And people voted for the right, declaring that actually this was going to be the type of governance that they wanted to make their lives better, especially farmers or employees who felt that actually their purchasing power, because of high inflation, energy costs, etc., was going down. But what's really interesting is the voting patterns don't reflect what people are actually saying in surveys. The fact of the matter is that most people are still truly concerned about nature, because part of that pushback in terms of the governance was also around climate change, or so we thought. But no, most of the Europeans that were actually interviewed still believe that nature is fundamental. Most people agree that there is a need for massive action on climate across a variety of different sectors. And what's really interesting is they're even saying that they're willing to pay for it as long as they see themselves paying a fair share. And this is where the psychology comes in. It's the fair share. It's the inequality element. It's the fact that that 1,400% CEO growth in salary is starting to show that we have real unfairness across most of our economies. And people are hijacking the climate narrative as a way to say, the more we decarbonize, the more we respect nature, the more unfair your life is going to be. This has also had a direct impact on trust, which is also fundamental. Now, why is this important? Because we've been trying to bring people a different way of looking at the economy. We've been talking about beyond growth. We've been trying to bring people on a journey, telling them that new economic models will actually make their lives better, that we need social and environmental risk to be taken into account in our financial and economic decision-making, that we need to correct the inequity, both between high and low-income countries, but also within our own countries, that we need to have a totally different perspective on public goods, and that we need to increase the agency of women and all workers. And we are trying to bring forward that message of hope when actually many people are angry and frustrated and don't know if they can trust us to actually make their lives better. That is what Earth for All is all about, showing people that GDP growth plus population growth plus climate change actually has a negative result in terms of well-being. It means that we need to bring forward some pathways for change, and that's what we did. We came up with 5 key turnarounds. And we started to actually look at the interrelationship between these turnarounds. How can we reduce poverty? How can we increase empowerment, reduce inequality, and ensure that people have access to affordable, nutritious, and clean food and energy? This is one of what we call the spaghetti graphs, the interrelationships of our system dynamic model. If you look at all the way at the top, you can see births and population growth, and you can look at the causal links with public spending and social trust. Everything is related. But here's the key aha moment. The speed of action on planetary boundaries is a function of the speed of action on inequality and poverty. So we come back to the essence of what is wrong with our societies. And that is why we decided that we need to actually plot out 2 key scenarios. One, which is the too little, too late scenario, which basically is today's scenario. Even using some of the technologies that we have today, we're still in the too little, too late. We know that we have passed 1.3 degrees, and we're actually now close or moving in on 1.5, and we've had several days this year at 1.5 or 2 degrees already. So too little, too late means that we continue to have extreme heat, droughts, floods, and climate impacts. However, there's the giant leap scenario. The giant leap scenario takes us to a well-being economy, and it only costs us 2 to 4% of global GDP per annum. In comparison, ladies and gentlemen, to the newest results coming out of the Potsdam Institute on Climate Change and Economics, which has said that if we get to 1.5 degrees, it's going to cost us 10 to 15% of GDP per annum. So we already know that the cost of inaction is greater than the cost of action. And we know that with a giant leap, we can reduce by half our greenhouse gas emissions and our CO2. We also know that we can increase phenomenally our well-being, putting in place policy recommendations that go from, for example, creating the fiscal space for most of our global South countries by actually eliminating debt, by starting to think about what we call special drawing rights, by taxing wealth because of the lack of wealth distribution that we see. And what's really important is that it will stop the playing out of what we saw just happen now in terms of the European elections. If we deal with well-being, if we deal with inequality, maybe people will vote differently. Because that social tension, that pressure, that anxiety will actually decrease. And that is what we show through our analysis and through achieving the giant leap. What does this mean for the textile industry? Why is this relevant? Because every single day, the relationship between fashion, labor rights, environmental impacts is there. The way in which the fashion industry can communicate with consumers and actually transform their lives in a better way, empower them to become a part of this transition journey, is there. We know that with the 17 global SDGs, the textile and fashion industry can really play a very important part. We also know that actually we can focus on some of those key SDGs and integrate them into everything that we do, whether we are a consumer, a producer, all parts of the fashion value chain can be part of our transformation and our implementation of the SDGs. Because of emissions and energy consumption and the water which is required, are all absolutely fundamental in transforming the industry into an industry that is truly sustainable. But what I find so fascinating is the link with inequality and poverty. It's the link with consumption. If the fashion industry can show the way that we need less, but we need better, that we can consume less, but we can consume better, that already is a huge impact in the lives of most citizens. What we decided is to translate this from the perspective of the United Nations and trying to see how we could apply our Earth for All model into an SDG for all model. There are two key red flags. If we continue on the too little, too late, but even with the giant leap, it's going to be hard for us to meet our climate goals, and it's hard for us to meet our gender goals. In fact, our gender goals might take up to 350 years at the pace that we're at. But what we say is we can achieve the SDGs and create a world which is more resilient to future shocks and stresses if we do things differently. This means implementing a fair yet radical transformation to support well-being economies and a thriving biosphere. But action needs to start now. This is why being here is so important. And it needs to start at a scale that we've never seen before. And we've transformed those SDGs in looking clearly through the lens of our five key turnarounds. What does that mean in terms of the poverty turnaround? It means expanding, as I said, the fiscal space so that developing countries can actually start to thrive, not just survive, not just pay off debt or their trade deficits. It means that we need to look at global financial architecture. It means that we need to address clean technology and leapfrogging IPs and new economic indicators. In terms of inequality, same thing. But most important, and this is actually happening right now, countries across the globe are calling for wealth taxation. And we are leading a huge campaign in this area. Looking at strengthened labor rights, safety nets, and innovation nets. And then for the empowerment turnaround, it means gender equality, but also access to education. It means access to decision making. It means women around the world are not just about having a quota, but we actually need more women to be respected in terms of their role in the economy across a variety of different sectors. And then, of course, the food turnaround and the energy turnaround are fundamental in terms of ensuring that we have a clean energy and an affordable, nutritious food transition. For the policy interventions, we have taken each one of the different SDGs and transformed them into key policy recommendations. We're having these discussions continuously with policymakers across the globe to ensure that they understand that by implementing those five key turnarounds, again, it's not too costly, but most importantly, most of the solutions are here. This is about just implementing, in most cases, what we have. But it also means that we need to address the economics of it all. How do we consume differently? How do we put in place new indicators that place a measure on more than just productivity? Especially if we know that if we continue to only measure productivity by 1.5 degrees, as I said, we will actually be losing 10% of our GDP. And you can see that we've done this for the inequality turnaround and the empowerment turnaround, putting in place very clear policy recommendations. We've translated this now into new recommendations for the European Union, for the African region, and also for the Latin American region in working with the UN, using our system dynamic model and translating into what do we need to do for each SDG. And I'm going to finish with this, because for me, this is the real reality check. We currently live in a world where the economy no longer functions to service people, definitely not planet, and definitely not prosperity. We live in a world where we are crowdfunding disaster. And this is a speech that I gave on the floor of Wall Street, saying very clearly to all traders, uncontrollable growth and an over-financialized economy that only values shareholder value above people, planet, and prosperity will crowdfund disaster. It is time to change the rules of the game so people, planet, and prosperity come first before power and profit. The only way to build resilience to future shocks and stresses is to invest in an Earth for All. And again, that's only costing us 2 to 4% of GDP, far less than most defense budgets across the globe. Mark my words, there are no stocks, no bonds, no financial assets, no business prospects on an unstable or dead planet. We have no choice but to redesign our systems towards a regenerative development that fosters well-being and an Earth for All. Ladies and gentlemen, I urge you to join this journey of change. There is an alternative future. We're all part of it. And I hope that you will read our book. And if you are interested, we have a few copies, and I'll be signing where the books are, somewhere here, and I'm not sure where that is, but I'm sure Nina or Amanda will let you know. This is all the information you need to know about the work that we're doing. This is not just about a book. This is a journey that we're creating together to create a better world for all of us. Thank you very much.